These stones are concretions, solidifications of substances that occur usually within the kidney, but can occur actually anywhere in the urinary tract. The exact cause and pathophysiology is not quite understood at the present time, but we do know that there are certain risk factors. First of all, as far as how many people will get stone disease, roughly 9% of our population are at risk for actually having a stone sometime in their life. And unfortunately, the risk is actually increasing in all age groups, all races, and in both genders. There's five different types of stone, major stones. Most stones are calcium-based, and the exact pathophysiology of calcium-based stones is not 100% known at this time, but it's something that's being worked on. A lot of research is being done to try to figure out why. Other types of stones, such as uric acid stones, we understand how that forms because of a low pH of the urine and just excessive amounts of uric acid in the urine. We do know that there is a huge genetic component, especially for those that are that have calcium stones, those that have cystine stones, but also diet and weight, specifically obesity, is a risk factor for stone disease. So in general, we don't necessarily screen for kidney stones. They're usually diagnosed when someone presents with signs or symptoms. Usually it's pain that someone will present with. They might also have blood in the urine, or what we call hematuria. And it could also be someone could have recurrent urinary tract infections, which when worked up, they're found to have a stone as the cause. Also, in today's world where we're frequently getting an imaging study for some other reason, it's not uncommon to incidentally find a kidney stone within a patient that's completely asymptomatic. It's my philosophy that kidney stone disease is really a recurrent disease that requires constant attention. So once you have it, you have to assume that it's going to happen again. So I think it's very important that you work it up, try to figure out why it's happening, and then try to do things, and sometimes it's just simple things that can really have a big impact in preventing kidney stones in the future.
The treatment of stone disease in our department is treatment for complex and complicated stones. So basically, we are a state-of-the-art department, and our referral comes from urologists with patients of complex disease. The most common treatment for stones is called extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy. This is the famous stone machine. This is where stones are fragmented in the body without any instrumentation. And this is done most commonly for patients with stones in the kidney. Now, there are certain limitations to the success of this treatment, like when the stone is very big, then there's a lot of stone gravel that has to pass naturally, and often the ureter cannot accommodate so many stone pieces going down. So there's a blockage in the ureter, and then one has to do something to take care of that. And this is when patients commonly are referred to a referral center such as the USC Urology Department. In those cases, we used to go from below, meaning with the patient under anesthesia, we look inside the bladder. With a tiny telescope, we look up into the ureter, and then we break those stones up with laser and remove the stone pieces with little baskets. This is called ureteroscopic surgery. Now, when there's residual from a previous treatment or larger stones in the kidney, then we can extend this treatment going all the way up into the kidney with flexible instruments, tiny flexible telescopes that allow us to see the stones wherever they are and to direct laser energy directly onto these stones, break them up, and then remove the stone pieces with little baskets. This is for stones of intermediate size, from about a couple millimeters to 1.5 to 2.5 centimeters. Often, we get referred very big stones, stones that can fill the entire kidney. They are called Stachon stones. In those instances, we actually have to make a little track from the outside into the kidney under X-ray control. We place a little sleeve inside the kidney, and then we can look directly inside the kidney, break up the stones with ultrasound, pneumatic energy, or with laser, and remove the stone pieces directly to the outside. This is called percutaneous lithotripsy. So with the combination of all these technologies, we can take care of patients with the most complex and complicated stone disease. As a referral center, we get the very big stones, the very complex stones. They fill the entire kidney. They're called Stekhon stones. Now those we approach from the outside. So we make a little channel through the skin into the kidney, put the sleeve inside the kidney, and then we can look directly into the kidney. We break up the stone with ultrasound or pneumatic energy, which is like a little jackhammer, or again with the laser, and remove all the pieces directly from the kidney. This is what we do for the very big stones. So with the technologies and the techniques that we have in the referral center, we can basically take care of all stones, even the most complex, in minimally invasive, outpatient or overnight surgical procedures. Stone disease has a recurrence rate of about 70% over 10 years. And in a comprehensive stone center, such as a university center like at USC, we actually offer also management of recurrence, which means reducing the risk of recurrence. First, we want to identify the stone composition. We want to find out what a stone risk profile is. This is where we ask the patient to do a 24-hour urine collection that we send to a laboratory that specializes in stone disease. We also take some blood tests, and this together gives a stone risk profile. This allows us to tell the patient exactly what to do to stay out of trouble. First, increasing fluid intake, which is commonly a problem, reducing salt intake, identifying dietary factors that we can change, and as the fourth would be taking medications that reduce the risk for future stone recurrence.